Al-Ahzab 33.50. O Prophet, surely we have made lawful to you your wives, whom you have given their dowries, and those whom your right hand possesses, out of those whom Allah has given to you as prisoners of war. And a believing woman, if she gave herself to the Prophet, if the Prophet desired to marry her, especially for you, not for the rest of the believers. We know what we have ordained for them concerning their wives and those whom their right hands possess, in order that no blame may attach to you. This is another special command that Muhammad handed down to himself, that allows virtually unlimited sex, divinely sanctioned by Allah. One assumes that this revelation was meant to assuage some sort of disgruntlement in the community over Muhammad's hedonism. Al-Ahzab 33.51. You may put off whom you please of them, and you may take to you whom you please, and whom you desire of those whom you had separated provisionally. No blame attaches to you. This is most proper, so that their eyes may be cool, and they may not grieve, and that they should be pleased. This is in reference to the situation in which Muhammad's wives were grumbling about his preference for sleeping with a slave girl, Mary the Copt, instead of them. Accordingly, Muhammad may sleep with whichever wife or slave he wishes without having to hear the others complain, as revealed in Allah's literal and perfect words to more than a billion Muslims. Al-Tahrim 66.1. O Prophet, why ban thou that which Allah hath made lawful for thee, seeking to please thy wives? Another remarkable verse of sexual convenience concerns the episode in which Muhammad's wives were jealous of the attention that he was giving to the Christian slave girl Maria. But, as he pointed out to them, to neglect the sexual availability of his slaves was against Allah's will for him. An-Nisa 4.24. And all married women are forbidden unto you, save those captives whom your right hands possess. Allah even permitted Muhammad and his men to rape married slaves, such as those captured in battle. Muhammad also passed down revelations from Allah that clearly condoned sleeping with underage girls, even by the standard of puberty. Quran 65.4 lays down rules for divorce, one of them being that a waiting period of 3 months is established to determine that the woman is not pregnant. But the same rule applies to those, too, who have not had their courses, meaning girls who have not begun to menstruate. Al-Talaq 65.4. Such of your women as have passed the age of monthly courses, for them, the prescribed period, if ye have any doubt, is 3 months. And for those who have no courses, it is the same. Sahih al-Bukhari hadith 7.18, narrated by Ursa. The Prophet asked Abu Bakr for Aisha's hand in marriage. Abu Bakr said, "But I am your brother." The Prophet said, "You are my brother in Allah's religion and his book, but she is lawful for me to marry." Abu Bakr was so shocked at Muhammad's proposal to marry his child Aisha of 6 years that he told him, "But I am your brother." This word "but," which is in Arabic innama, brings out the true disbelief of Abu Bakr regarding the request, which of course turned out to be an unchallengeable demand. Abu Bakr's shock alone is evidence that what Muhammad was demanding was against the social norms of even the pagans of 1400 years ago. Since his companions actually believed him as the messenger of Allah, Muhammad was able to fulfill each and every one of his fantasies, lusts, and desires. Muhammad was able to receive alleged divine verses sanctifying them with made-to-order revelations from his accomplice, the ever-obedient and willing Allah. Sahih al-Bukhari hadith 7.88, narrated by Ursa. The Prophet wrote the marriage contract with Aisha while she was 6 years old and consummated his marriage with her while she was 9 years old, and she remained with him for 9 years, i.e. till his death. Sahih al-Bukhari 8.151, narrated by Aisha. I used to play with the dolls in the presence of the Prophet, and my girlfriends also used to play with me. When Allah's apostle used to enter my dwelling place, they used to hide themselves, but the Prophet would call them to join and play with me. The dolls were something to play with when Muhammad was not having sex with her. Ladies and gentlemen, be aware that dolls are forbidden in Muhammadan Islam for grown-ups. They were allowed for Aisha because she had not yet reached the age of puberty. Fath al-Bari, page 143, volume 13, asserts this. Muhammad's sexual antics are an embarrassment to those Muslims who are aware of them. This is particularly so for the Prophet's marriage to Aisha when she was 9 years old. The thought of a 52-year-old man sleeping and bathing with a child girl is intensely unpleasant, and it reflects the disgusting character of a sexual glutton rather than a holy man. Critics even allege that Muhammad was a pedophile. The critics are wrong, because he was not a serial child molester. Nonetheless, according to any logical, decent, and moral person, Muhammad raped Aisha, since even if she were in puberty at age 9, the fact still remains that she was neither of age of consent, nor was she allowed to refuse her parents. Some Muslims respond by denying the hadith itself, which is a stupid mistake. The accounts of Muhammad having sex with a 9-year-old are no less reliable than those on which the five pillars of Islam are based. They have been an accepted part of tradition and did not become controversial until social mores began to change with the modern age. Zainab was in her 30s when she attracted the unquenchable lust of Muhammad. We don't know the age of Muhammad's sex slaves. They may or may not have been as young as Aisha, but there is no point in speculating. Thanks to Muhammad's lack of morals, sex with children became deeply ingrained in the Islamic tradition. For many centuries, Muslim armies would purge Christian and Hindu peasant villages of their menfolk and send the women and children to harems and the thriving child sex slave markets deep in the Islamic world. From Ayatollah Khomeini's book, Tahrir al-Masail, a man can marry a girl younger than 9 years of age, even if she is a girl still a baby being breastfed. A man, however, is prohibited from having intercourse with a girl younger than 9. Other sexual acts, such as foreplay, rubbing, kissing, and sodomy, is allowed. A man having intercourse with a girl younger than 9 years of age has not committed a crime, but only an infraction, if the girl is not permanently damaged. If the girl, however, is permanently damaged, the man must provide for her all her life. But this girl will not count as one of the man's 4 permanent wives. He also is not permitted to marry the girl's sister. End quote. Some clerics show relative mercy on underage girls by advocating a process known as thying that Muhammad used with Aisha from when she was 6 years old till he penetrated her at age 9. According to a recent fatwa known as 23672, the Imam answers a question. My parents married me to a young girl who has not yet reached puberty. How can I enjoy her sexually? By telling the man that he may hug her, kiss her, and ejaculate between her legs. In summary, Islam's holiest texts portray Muhammad not as a perfect man, but a sexual hedonist. Not only did he become fat from indulging in food, but his pursuit of sex was no less gluttonous. On top of it all, he used personal made-to-order revelations from Allah to justify his debauchery to the gullible masses, which, to this day, continue to be venerated and memorized as if they are the holiest of utterances. Muhammad's pursuit of Zainab, the wife of his adopted son, is almost as tough for Muslims to explain. This is because it not only raises a similar question of moral character, but also casts suspicion on whether his so-called prophecies were really divine revelations or dictates of personal convenience. So controversial was Muhammad's desire to marry his adopted son's wife that he had to justify it with a stern pronouncement from Allah on the very institution of adoption, which has had tragic consequences to this day. verses 33.4 to 5 are widely interpreted to imply that Islam is against adoption, meaning that an untold number of children in the Islamic world have been needlessly orphaned, all because Muhammad's lustful desires for a married woman went beyond even what the other six wives that he possessed at the time and a multitude of slaves could satisfy. Muhammad forbade his 10 widows from remarrying, even making sure that this divine order was forever preserved in the eternal word of Allah, Quran 33.53. To add insult to injury, they were all summarily disinherited from Muhammad's estate by his successor, courtesy of another divine order given to Abu Bakr from Allah. I have only dealt with Muhammad's sexual mores without referring to other unsavory characteristics, such as deceptions, betrayals of trust, assassinations, mass murder, plunder, rape, etc., which will require many more chapters addressing each of them. I leave it to those who are listening or reading my reports to decide your judgment. As far as I'm concerned, I do not have the stomach for any more than these. Al-Ahzab 33.50. O Prophet, surely we have made lawful to you your wives, whom you have given their dowries, and those whom your right hand possesses, out of those whom Allah has given to you as prisoners of war. And a believing woman, if she gave herself to the Prophet, if the Prophet desired to marry her, especially for you, not for the rest of the believers. We know what we have ordained for them concerning their wives and those whom their right hands possess, in order that no blame may attach to you. This is another special command that Muhammad handed down to himself that allows virtually unlimited sex, divinely sanctioned by Allah. One assumes that this revelation was meant to assuage some sort of disgruntlement in the community over Muhammad's hedonism. Al-Ahzab 33.51. You may put off whom you please of them, and you may take to you whom you please, and whom you desire of those whom you had separated provisionally. No blame attaches to you. This is most proper, so that their eyes may be cool and they may not grieve, and that they should be pleased. This is in reference to the situation in which Muhammad's wives were grumbling about his preference for sleeping with a slave girl, Mary the Copt, instead of them. Accordingly, Muhammad may sleep with whichever wife or slave he wishes without having to hear the others complain, as revealed in Allah's literal and perfect words to more than a billion Muslims. Al-Tahrim 66.1. O Prophet, why ban thou